Hello, I'm Tony Guida. This is my New York. Startling news today. Everything you've ever learned about the history of the world is wrong. First of all, there was no Big Bang. It was actually the Big Shebang, the woman-powered story of creation narrated by God the Mother in this rip-roaring graphic novel. Author and New Yorker cartoonist Marisa Acocella is ready to introduce you to a pantheon of powerful goddesses. Next. Marisa Acocella, welcome back to the program. It's good to see you.
I'm so happy to be here, Tony. Thank you for having me back.
Well, and you arrive with a rip-roaring rewrite of history. It's intense, it's irreverent, it knocks every creation myth I've ever heard of on its butt.
That's what I wanted.
I'd ask you to summarize the thing, but I think that's a bit much to ask. It's complicated. Maybe you could just give us the premise and we can go from there.
Okay, well, the Big Shebang, the Herstory of the universe, according to God the Mother, is really about the women who have been marginalized, minimized, maligned, sidelined, slut-shamed, unnamed, and as God the Mother would tell you, all right, she has been...
Holy ghosted, I think you said.
I was just going to say that. I am God the Mother, and I have been holy ghosted.
Exactly.
And why is that, you might ask? Okay, that's because history is just that, his story. When we hear from her and when we hear her story, the whole paradigm shifts. Our story shifts, the story of woman shifts. And we realize that when men and women are equal and they're on equal, even keel. And if you take like Eve, for instance, Eve, we were told that she came out of Adam's rib, right? Mm-hmm. Well, according to Apocrypha, according to Nag Hammadi, Eve was basically the divine spark. Eve comes down from the Pleroma, from the heavens. She's the divine spark. She is God the Mother's daughter. She is Sophia's daughter. Sophia is a daughter of God the Mother. That's the other suppressed myth that we'll get into. She breathes into Adam and gives him life. She gives him soul. She is the mother of the living. So Eve was powerful. She was not a scapegoat. She was a shivolutionary.
Well,
she
yeah, I mean, your history refutes the idea, among others, as you're saying, that Eve is responsible for the fall of mankind.
No, she's responsible for all of mankind. There's a big difference. You drop the F.
Yeah. And well, we should get back to God the Mother for a minute, okay, because she's the first.
She's the first power.
She's the first power in this book, and which makes God the Father, whom we hear about an awful lot. We never hear about God the Mother. Mm-hmm. God the Father, I guess, becomes the first virgin birth.
Yes, that is exactly right. God the Mother was here first, was everything, and then she gives birth to God the Father. I mean, when you think about it, how could a man possibly give birth to all this? Not only did God the Mother give birth to everything, she gave birth to God the Father. He was the first virgin birth. And then together, the Big Shebang is just that. It's a big, gigantic, earth-shattering, universe-creating orgasm that gave birth to everything.
Okay. We should take a closer look just at your drawing of God the Mother. I recall you saying, perhaps the last time you're on this program, but you've said it many times, that as a child you were drawing, and at 8 years old, you drew a blonde bombshell. And is God the Mother, is that the bombshell grown up?
I think you could say that she actually is, because I was drawing the archetypal female. My mother was a shoe designer. She designed shoes for Delman. And one day when she was pregnant with me, she got a phone call from this woman who said, "Hi, this is Jackie. Can I speak to the designer, Jackie Kennedy?" And my mother was like, "Oh my gosh, somebody's playing a joke on me. This can't possibly be you." And she said, no, it's really me. I'm a size 11 shoe. And my mother in her Jersey accent said, well, I'm a size 11, we could commiserate. So what happened was Jackie said that she needed a shoe for a very big event. And guess what the event was?
I imagine it was what, the inauguration?
Yes, my mother designed Jackie's shoes for JFK's inauguration. Mm. So Jackie gave birth to John John, my mother gave birth to me, and my mother worked at home and she would do these trend reports with these fabulous women wearing her fabulous shoes, and I would imitate her at three. And then by seven, I got really, really bored with them because they weren't saying anything. So we had this vacation in Bermuda, which wound up being, we wound up staying in James Thurber's house. And I saw these drawings on the walls with captions on them. And I realized the women that I was drawing, they could actually talk. So that's how I started really writing stories and became a cartoonist. But I forgot about that and went into advertising and then had a Saturn return and became a cartoonist later on. But yeah, so that long story short, that blonde that I was drawing ever since I could remember, that archetypal female, that is God the Mother.
And she's wearing a very starry, what, pantsuit, would you call it?
She's wearing a jumpsuit made of stars and a cape that goes on to infinity. She's got an infinity cape that goes on and on and on and on and on and on out into the universe because she can. She's God the Mother.
She's a pretty hot babe.
Well, of course she is. She's like gave birth to everything. Why wouldn't she be the most beautiful babe in the universe?
In fact, most of the goddesses in this book are quite attractive. You've got Eve, you've got Sophia, the daughter of God the Mother and Father, Mary Magdalene.
Here's the thing about Mary Magdalene. There's been so much that's been written about her, but if anybody has been marginalized, minimized, sidelined, maligned, and slut-shamed, who deserves a page one rewrite, it's Mary Magdalene, right? Mm-hmm. And we find out, I did so much research, I can't even tell you, I must have read about 200 books. I read everything I could possibly read on Mary Magdalene and did a download and just realized that Mary Magdalene, you know how the Virgin Mary got a visitation from the Archangel Gabriel? Mm-hmm. Right? Well, Mary Magdalene's mother was a queen. Queen Eucharis had eyes that could not see and ears that could not hear. And Gabriel came and said, I bring you good news. You're going to have a daughter. And she couldn't hear it. And then when she gave birth to Mary Magdalene, she realized that her daughter was really special. But her husband, King Cyrus, who was one of the kings of the 12 tribes of Israel, didn't want to know about his daughter. He wanted to give birth to a son. What happened was Mary Magdalene, who was a princess, was sent to Babylon. And here it is, a princess, her dowry, her entourage of handmaids, bodyguards, and a caravan on the treacherous road to Babylon. What could possibly go wrong, right? I don't know if you could see that. And what happened was a gang of thieves stole her dowry, murdered her bodyguards, assaulted her handmaids, who were collateral damage for the real target, me. And Mary Magdalene was sex trafficked and sold into prostitution. Here's this princess, she's 16 and was sex trafficked. So what happened was she comes back, she makes enough money, she frees her sisters who are prostitutes and frees herself and comes back and she meets Jesus and has this incredible, incredible love story.
Yes, with Jesus.
With Jesus, her winds up being her husband. Mary Magdalene is not only beautiful, but she becomes the apostle who knew all. She was the first apostle, and she was involved in a triangle with Peter, who was so, 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 so jealous of Mary Magdalene.
Okay, the first love triangle.
Yeah, go figure.
Yeah, you mentioned how much research, how much reading you've done, and I was impressed I got lost in this book a few times, but what among the things that comes through is the amount of digging, the amount of deep diving you did into the myths, into the Bible. Mm-hmm. I think you've said you worked 3 years on the book, but you had the idea for 25. Is that right?
I've had this idea for 25 years, the big shebang. And I always wanted to do I always thought, you know, God the mother gave birth to the universe, as I said. It never made sense that a man gave birth to all this. And there's God, and it's the law of creation, is a law of balance. And that's one of the other things that I wanted to really stress in this book, is that, you know, a patriarchy and a matriarchy, they're both two sides of the same coin, and it's really about balance. This world is about balance. It's about balancing the male and the female. That's why the story of Jesus and Mary Magdalene is so important. But I did have this idea 25 years ago, and I felt like I needed to grow into it and be mature enough to write this story and really do a deep, deep, deep dive on our Herstory.
What you're saying kind of calls to mind for me a quote from Maya Angelou in her wonderful book, I Know How the Caged Bird Sings. She says, there is no greater agony than bearing an untold story inside you. I don't get the sense it was agony for you, but this was an untold story for a long time.
It was an untold story, and it was always in the back of my mind, and it was always something that I really wanted to write, but I wanted to write it in the right way and have the knowledge to write it and the human experience. I felt like I had to grow into the story. So it was kind of like creation, giving birth. I was giving birth to this book. Yeah.
Early in the book, mm-hmm. God the Mother says to you, the story that I'm going to tell you, is essentially about a book written by a bunch of men about a bunch of men, referring mm-hmm. to the Bible.
Right.
And you did apparently some very extensive research into the Bible as well to put this together.
Mm-hmm. I did. Well, the thing about the Bible is it was edited by a bunch of men for a bunch of men to make sure those bunch of men maintained control. Now, I also want to stress that this is not a slam against men, just those men, the Roman Emperor Constantine and the Council of Nicaea, who basically cut any mention of God the Mother out of the Bible, holy ghosted her, rolled back women deacons and priests, which were in existence back then, and cut out stories about empowered women who really had these magnificent power struggles and were victorious. Those stories were cut out. So that's why I say it's, you know, the Bible is the book about a bunch of men, about a bunch of men.
Yeah. You and I have a good friend, another New Yorker cartoonist named Mort Gerber.
We love him.
And he was reminding me that he did a cartoon on this subject about men writing out of history, eliminating history. And let's take a look at his cartoon, Noah's Ark. There's Noah painting his name on the side of his ship, his ark, but the lady standing down there by the ladder is looking up and saying, what about my name, Noah's wife?
Well, Mort, I don't know whether he knew this, but he was so right about Noah's wife. She's mentioned in the Bible, but every time she's mentioned as Noah's wife, but she does not have a name. That's why I say that women were marginalized, maligned, minimized, and unnamed. Noria is Noah's wife. She does not have a name in the book written by a bunch of men about a bunch of men in the Bible. So not only is she Noah's wife, but she's Eve's daughter. How about that?
How about that?
Well,
and yet, you know, I never heard of the ark called Noah and Noria's ark. It's just mm-hmm. Noah's ark. Thank you, Mort.
Yeah, thank you, Mort, for that, for sure.
We should get to some other things in the book and where women are, if not marginalized, actually attacked and in some cases eliminated. I mean, the whole Salem witch business is horrific.
It is horrific. 9 million women, mostly women, there were some men, were killed.
That number is under question, but I don't imagine it was, you know, I'm not saying there were only six or seven. There were a lot.
And, you know, I wasn't there. Who was there? That was a number that I read, according to Merlin Stone and a few other sources. So everything is up for interpretation, as are these myths. This is the result of my research. Irregardless, there are a lot of people killed. So let's just go with that, right? And the witch hunts. And I think this is a great tragedy, how we allow this to happen and how women's voices and men's voices were squelched.
Well, a fundamental to that is, how would you put it, that the men of that time, of that era, devalued or feared women so much they had to accuse them of witchery?
Well, they did it because, for a number of reasons. It was maybe because a man desired a woman and she didn't feel the same way. So he said, he accused her of witchery, or he would say she made his penis vanish. Sorry, can I say that?
Sure.
Okay, so women were accused of like the craziest things you would ever hear. So, and it was also, witch hunting was big business. Not if women owned their own homes, what would happen? You kill the woman, then you get the house. So you would get, there was like a lot of, there was money involved. I mean, it was like these men were making money off these dead women.
You said earlier, Marisa, that The Big Shebang, your book, is not designed to be a hit on all men. You said those men.
Right.
But among those men is someone contemporary, a fellow named Weinstein, who gets predictable and deserved rough treatment in the book, as he should.
He totally does.
Among your goddesses, or what do you call them?
Evolutionaries.
Your term for revolutionaries. Right. These people are not picking that up. Among the she-volutionaries in the story, late in the story, are all those actresses who came out and took down Harvey.
Well, I so admire the courage of those women. Rose McGowan, Rosanna Arquette, Lucia Evans, who isn't even an actress, and Annabella Sciarra, who's a really dear friend of mine. She has so much courage, and she withstood that trial and she took Harvey down, and he deserved it. And he has
want to get to besides this book is it you seem to have taken it a step further and actually taught yourself animation to produce. Let's take a look at one of your mission control animations about Harvey Weinstein.
Please. No, please, no.
3, 2, 1, liftoff.
No!
Yes!
I'm the scariest you'll ever have as an enemy in this town.
Hello.
Mission Control, this is Mars.
Yes, Mars.
Mars?
We don't want Harvey Weinstein. We already have testosterone poisoning.
Hey!
Shut up, Harvey.
I went back to School of Visual Arts and was taught animation, and then I created Mission Control, a series, a three-part webisode, and basically send Harvey Weinstein into outer space. And when he gets launched into outer space, and the women who were the Me Too women were the actresses, were behind Mission Control. And when Harvey gets launched into outer space, Mars doesn't even want him because Mars says there's already testosterone poisoning. So get lost, Harvey. So he's like lost somewhere in the universe.
I like that.
Before I went to jail, so.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think outer space is even too good for him, but
I agree.
But I like that turn that Mars, the god of war, and you know, macho, said no.
Get lost.
Not here. I want to talk a moment about a graphic novel. You're this creation, and you had a graphic memoir, Cancer Vixen. You were on the program earlier a couple of years ago with another graphic novel, Antenna. Mm-hmm. It's just a remarkable, to me, it's a remarkable creation, because the idea of a graphic novel, because it's not only you writing the story, mm-hmm. but you illustrating the story, and even lettering, I think, in your case, the story. And I'm just intrigued by how exhaustive and intense that must be.
Well, it's funny that you bring up the artwork and the lettering, because that was, oh my gosh. When I was drawing God the Mother, I actually, in the middle of the book, really got her look down. So I had to go back and redraw her from the very beginning. I made her more of a spirit instead of a skin tone, because she was Holy Ghosted and I wanted her to be a little more inclusive in that regard. So I went back and restyled her. Then I had to go back and do the lettering. I actually set a typeface based in my handwriting and it didn't work out. I didn't like the way it looked. So I went back just when the book was about to go into print and pulled the typeface and relettered all 256 pages in 2 weeks. I can't tell you what that was like.
Oh my goodness.
It was so stressful. Oh my God. It's like I'm giving birth. No, I'm not giving birth. Talking about creation.
Yeah, talk about intense. How does the image of, let's say, God the Mother or Eve or Persephone or anybody else, what's the process you go through to try to visualize that person, mythological or otherwise?
Well, in the case of Sophia, let's say, the daughter of God the Mother, well, they were serpentine, they were spirits. So, and Sophia was the daughter of God the Mother, so I wanted her to look like God the Mother but younger, and just give her a little bit of a different skin tone. And since she was younger and more of spirit, you see through her. So yeah. I did that. With Eve, did you know that Eve was actually a real person, and she actually has a grave somewhere in the Middle East? Like, you could go visit Adam and Eve's grave. Yeah. So Eve, I heard from the legend, was about 9 or 10 feet tall. And back then, of course, as we said, that she was a divine spark. So she was more translucent as well. And she was more light. She wasn't as dense as we are. We've sunk into matter. So I gave her like the sparkly kind of thing because she's divine spark. And then she's also the tree. So I gave her leaves and like a dress made of leaves that trail wherever she goes. So that's my look for Eve. Mary Magdalene, the bracelet that she wears.
Mm-hmm. It looks like a serpent.
It's a serpent. Well, that's because she's master of the Kundalini snake when she went to Isis's mystery school in Egypt, where her parents sent her to school. And that's the actual bracelet. And I was questioning that because I went online, what was Mary Magdalene's bracelet? And I saw that bracelet. Then I would go to the Metropolitan Museum just for reference when I was doing the Egyptian goddesses. And I saw that actual bracelet on one of the sarcophaguses. And I was like, oh my God, that is really real. So I did a lot of research and things just sort of like came to me as I was doing it.
Well, it's a marvelous creation. I do want to mention, say one more thing about Cancer Vixen, your best-selling memoir about your battle with breast cancer, successful, thankfully. And And what you did as a result of that, you established a foundation at Mount Sinai. Talk about that a little.
I did. When I was diagnosed with breast cancer, I didn't have health insurance. So I wanted to establish a foundation for women who didn't have health insurance. And I took a nice big chunk of money and I set it aside for free mammograms. And then out of that grew the foundation. And it's now at Mount Sinai. Before it was at St. Vincent's, but St. Vincent's is no longer here. So it's now Mount Sinai. And it's completely funded by Bloomingdale's. It's through a grant from Bloomingdale's. So the money goes directly to Mount Sinai at this point. And it's an empowerment program that's got Qigong, it's got creative writing, it's got a lot of different things to it. So I'm really happy about that because it's a free program for women who are going through breast cancer and also survivors at Mount Sinai downtown.
Marisa, it's the big shebang is one hell of a story. So interestingly written and illustrated. And I'm making a request of you right now. I know you'll write another book. I hope you're in the process, maybe even thinking about it. And when you do, you call me up and let's do this again.
I would love that. It's always such a great pleasure talking with you. We always have so much fun.
All right. Marisa Acocella, stay well. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. That was great. I really enjoyed it.